Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I want to welcome you and thanks for tuning in for our broadcast. I pray that the Lord's blessings be upon your life. Here at Bible Christian Church, we believe that the Word of God reveals God and brings blessings into the lives of those who hear it. So our prayer and our hope for you is that as you hear this message, that God would bless you and encourage you in your life. This morning I'm going to do things a little bit different. I'm doing this old school. If you got your Bibles, turn with me to Joshua chapter 6. Let me come down here for a minute. Look, does anybody here have friends, brothers, a dad, grandpa, uncle that just loves guns? All right, loves to go hunting. And all the people that I know that have weapons and have firearms, those kind of things, I noticed something kind of similar amongst them is that when gun lovers get together, they like to show each other their guns, and they like to, it's just like when car guys get together, they'll go into the garage to talk instead of in the living room. And it's like, let me show you what I'm working on. And I was sitting here looking at my Bible this morning with this cover I need to get fixed. It's starting to wear. I just wanted to share a quick story. Like I said, I'm doing things a little bit differently today. But many of you know that I spent about 3.5 years of my life behind bars. And there was a long stint that I did in Ellsworth, Kansas. It's a medium security prison there with a minimum side. There's one camp where it's minimum security and they can do work release and that kind of stuff. And while I was locked up in Ellsworth, I got involved with a prayer group. And I wouldn't be surprised if somebody in this church knows the person I'm about to talk about. But there's this guy by the name of Randy Snodgrass who, if you're not familiar with some of the things that go on in prisons across America. Randy was involved with a group when he was younger. Now, he's an old man now, but when he was younger, he was involved with a neo-Nazi group inside the prison walls. And he's been locked up in Hutch, and he's been locked up in Lansing, and he's been in the maximum security and these different things. And Randy's done some terrible things in his life to get himself locked up. And as far as I know, this might have changed, but as far as I can remember, Randy's not getting out of prison. He's going to die in there. And Randy, I met years after he had gone through his troubles, and Randy, as a matter of fact, has got a swastika tattooed on his forehead, and he's got SS symbols, lightning bolts on his forearms, other swastikas, and he's got German written on his back and all kinds of different things from like the Aryan Brotherhood and the neo-Nazis and these kinds of symbols tattooed all over his body. And when I met Randy, he'd grown his hair out. He wasn't a skinhead anymore. And he'd grown his hair out, and specifically he'd grown out his bangs so he could cover that tattoo on his forehead, because you know now he kind of lives in shame about some of the things that he'd done. I got involved in a Bible study in a prayer group with Randy, and he kind of shared with me some of his testimony and some of the hard times that he'd gone through being in Lansing and getting stabbed in the ribs with a pencil and all kinds of different things that he'd experienced while he was behind bars. And I was sitting in this Bible study with Randy, and I really got to know him. I spent enough time there to where I got to talk to him every single week when we'd have Bible study. I wasn't in the same building that Randy was in, but we would meet together at Bible study, and I would sit next to him, and Randy used to tease me, and he would pay attention to the little things that I would do, like if he would know if I picked my nose, you know what I mean? Like Randy like paid attention to his surroundings, and he would mimic your quirks and your personality. Like if you're the kind of person that's always rubbing your hands, when he talks to you, he'll rub his hands too. He's one of these people. And I sat with Randy and I spoke with him and I prayed with him, and I remember times where I'd cried with him and he'd shared about his family back home and all the things that he would never get to experience. And Randy had this Bible. This is actually his Bible. And Randy had this Bible, and it's a comparative study Bible. And what it is just basically it's four translations side by side on every page. So I've got the King James, the Amplified, the New American Standard, and the New International, the NIV. So I had this Bible, and every day you'd bring this big old Bible to Bible study, and we'd sit there and we'd read in it, we'd pray together. And I had my Bible, I had a King James version that I would read out of, but I was always fascinated, and I would sit next to him and I would look, okay, I'd be looking at my Bible, say, but what does the Amplified say? And then I'd be looking at my Bible and I'd say, well, what does the NIV say? And I would always look over his shoulder and I'd ask him, you know, and there's all kinds of footnotes and all kinds of stuff in here, and his name is even in here. There are passages of scripture where it'll say, you know, and you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins, and you is highlighted, and it's an arrow, and it's got Randy's name. This is talking about you, Randy. And it's got all these passages of scriptures that he's highlighted and that he's marked up. And through a course of events, you know, I'd shared with them that I really liked it. I thought it was really neat to have all those. I didn't want to carry four books with me, and I was really, really into studying the Word, and I wanted to know Jesus better and to know God better. And I would always sit there. It was almost like I was drooling over this Bible. I was breaking the 10th commandment. I was coveting it. I really strongly desired something that somebody else had. I was like, that'd be really cool if I could have that. And through a set of circumstances, because of the way that the prison system works, you can't just give stuff to people, well, at least legally. You know, guys are giving stuff and trading stuff all day long, but legally you have certain property that you're not allowed to just give to people. And so through some difficulties and some red tape, Randy eventually gave this to me. And he gave it to me as a gift. And he says, oh, I'll get others. He says, I know you really like it, and I want to help you with your Bible study. And he gave this to me, and I'll never forget that. And I remember when he gave it to me, he said, fight, 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 and fight with this thing until it sticks to your hand. Now, there's a story of one of David's mighty men. I don't know if you're familiar with this. It was one who stood on a plot of land, and he had his sword in his hand, and he was fighting, and he was killing Philistines, and they kept coming at him, and he stood his ground, and he had a sword in his hand, and the scripture said that he fought until his hand cleaved to his sword, like that it was stuck to him. And that's what Randy told me. He says, fight. He says, keep fighting till this thing sticks to your hand, till your hand cleaves to it, till it becomes a part of you. Now, that's something that they'll teach you in the service, and you know, even with police officers and different things, when they're training you how to use weapons. Now, we train differently now than we did back then. But of course, if you look at all different cultures that train people to do sword fighting and these kinds of things, when they would train people, they would train them in such a way that the sword that they would hold was not just a weapon that they would hold. It wasn't just an instrument that was some other thing that you would pick up when you need it. But the idea of the training with the sword is that it is a part of you. That the sword is actually an extension of your arm. It is not supposed to be something that is thought of as being apart from you. The sword itself is a part of who you are. And when you fight and when you war and when you watch some of these people, I watch, you know, videos, and maybe you're like me, you like action movies, and you watch these old ninja movies or the movies with, you know, knights and shining armor, and you watch the way that they use their swords and how it's very fluid, and wherever their arm goes, the sword goes, and it's like it's a part of them. And I think it's important for each and every one of us to learn this word and to study this word until it becomes a part of us, to understand the warfare that we are fighting. I'm going to use this kind of language as I'm talking here. I don't want to take up too much time. I don't want to preach very long. But desire and result are two different things. I have a desire not to preach very long, but we'll see what happens, so pray for me. All right? But in Joshua chapter 6, there is a lot of talk of military strategy. Up until this point, children of Israel had been wandering through the wilderness. And Moses then dies, and then Joshua, the son of Nun, comes up in his stead. Now, if you're not familiar with Joshua, Joshua is one of these young men that would go and do what he was told, and he had faith that was greater than most of the people around him. Him and Caleb are actually the two out of the 12 that went into the promised land that said, we can take it. 10 of those spies that went into the promised land were saying, no, there's giants, we look like grasshoppers to them, there's walled cities, there's all these different kind of things in the promised land, it's too hard for us. Joshua and Caleb were the two young men that said, no, we can surely take it because the Lord is with us. This is the Joshua that we're talking about. This is his book. There's types and shadows. There are so many types and shadows in this book and in this short story. I don't have enough time to go through every one of them, but I do want you to see some of the revelation that we can see in the New Testament, what it is that God wants to do through his people through this book. So, before I get started, will you just pray with me? Father God, I pray that whatever is not of you would be forgotten. I pray that your truth would stand. Help me. Help me to speak what the book speaks. Help me to say your words. I pray for your Holy Spirit to lead us all into your truth. I trust in the anointing that you have given me, that you've covered me and washed me through your Son Jesus and by your Holy Spirit. Cover and wash my words as well, Lord. Let everything that I speak be powerful and effective. May your church be equipped to war a good warfare and to fight for the faith, to use truth as a weapon. I pray that your love would be spread in such a way that in this community the name of Jesus would be lifted high, that it would be famous, and that his banner would fly in Ark City. Use us as your soldiers to make that happen. Use us as your spokespeople to speak your word. Use us as your witnesses, as your messengers. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Joshua chapter 6. I'm not going to read the whole thing. I'm going to read the first portion of this chapter. It says there, "Now Jericho was tightly shut because of the sons of Israel. No one went out and no one came in. The Lord said to Joshua, 'See, I have given Jericho into your hand with its king and the valiant warriors. You shall march around the city, all the men of war circling the city once. You shall do so for 6 days. Also, 7 priests shall carry 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark. Then on the 7th day, you shall march around the city 7 times, and the priests shall blow the trumpets. It shall be when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city will fall down flat, and the people will go up, every man straight ahead.' So Joshua, the son of Nun, called the priests and said to them, 'Take up the Ark of the Covenant, and let 7 priests carry 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the Ark of the Lord.' Then he said to the people, 'Go forward and march around the city, and let the armed men go on before the Ark of the Lord.' And it was so." Or how we would say, amen. "And it was so that when Joshua had spoken to the people, and the 7 priests carrying the 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the Lord went forward and blew the trumpets, and the ark of the Lord, ark of the covenant of the Lord, followed them. The armed men went before the priests who blew the trumpets, and the rear guard came after the ark, while they continued to blow the trumpets. But Joshua commanded the people, saying, 'You shall not shout, nor let your voice be heard, nor let a word proceed out of your mouth until the day I tell you, shout. Then you shall shout.' So he had the ark of the Lord taken around the city, circling it once. Then they came into the camp and spent the night in the camp." Amen. We'll stop there. Notice something I want you to notice here real quick. In the first passage, the first part of this passage of Scripture, in verse 2, it says, "Then the Lord said to Joshua." Joshua's army strategy for taking Jericho was not his idea. We got to get that straight. I don't know any military commander in the world that would think marching around a city is the best way to capture it. I don't care what you say, how many different shadows and types you use, or any kind of strategy you use. If you want to try to logically reason together with yourself and your brain and try to think of a way of how this is going to work, you're wasting your time. Logically, just with reason, physical evidence, and the way battles are fought, this does not make sense. I don't care what you say. Well, you could point out the number 7, and that there's the priests and the ark of the Lord, and you could point out that these were armed men, that they had the right instruments and they had the right weapons, and they had a, you know, a big enough army to maybe take Jericho. But strategically speaking, this plan does not make any sense. Doesn't make any sense. You guys remember that VeggieTales? This is maybe for you younger folk. The VeggieTales, where they would sing that song, and the ones in Jericho, they were singing that song, and they were mocking the children of Israel, and they're like, keep walking, but you won't knock down our wall. Keep walking, but she isn't going to fall. You remember that? You remember that? All right? Maybe some of you parents remember your kids watching that? That in that cartoon, I just remember that cartoon vividly because of my two older kids, Dominic and Kiera. They'd sing that song, and we talked about it one time driving in the car. It's like, how can walking around the city make a wall fall? It won't. It won't. Marching around the city is not, that is not what's going to make it happen. This doesn't make sense, but it's the command of the Lord. The Lord said to Joshua, back up real quick. I want you to see something. Back up to chapter 5. If you don't got a Bible, scoot close to somebody that does. That's all right. If your breath smells, hold it. Okay? Sit next to him close. And then when you're done, scoot back away. You'll be fine. All right. Joshua chapter 5. Look there in verse 13, it says, now it came about when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, a man was standing opposite him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went to him and said, are you for us or for our adversaries? He said, no. I love that. It's like, are you this or this? No. Like, neither. No. I've had people come to me and they talk about, well, is God completely sovereign and does man have free will? And I'm like, yes. They are both together. They work together. Well, here he says, no, neither. I indeed come now as a captain of the host of the Lord. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and bowed down and said, what has my Lord to say to his servant? The captain of the Lord's host said to Joshua, remove your sandals from your feet, for the place where you are standing is holy. And Joshua did so. There's been one other instance up to this point, well, not one, there's been a few, but there's one that really comes to mind. The number one, I mean, there's other times where people, they were standing on holy ground, they took off their sandals, but there's one that really, really comes to mind, and it's when Moses comes and there's this burning bush, and the voice tells him to remove the sandals from your feet because the ground you're standing on is holy ground. Now, the Bible tells us, and there's this command in the New Testament and the Old Testament, it says, be ye holy, for I am holy, thus saith the Lord. That your holiness is based on the fact that the Lord himself is holy. Now, this is just my interpretation, my opinion about this, but I think most Orthodox Christianity and scholars would agree with me on this point. The fact that the ground is holy has nothing to do with the ground. It has to do with who is there present. Moses was talking to a burning bush, and we say that it was the voice of the Lord that came from a burning bush, that the Lord himself had presented himself to Moses, and Moses was talking to the Lord, and the Lord said, the ground you're standing on is holy. Not because the ground itself was special, but because God himself was there and made it special. His presence is what makes it holy. And here you have the captain of the Lord's hosts. Now some have argued in saying that this is possibly Michael the archangel, who is the captain of the hosts of the Lord, and he is the prince over Israel. There are some that make that statement. And there are others who study Christology and this idea of studying Christ in the Old Testament, these pre-manger episodes before he became as a baby, that the idea that Christ is eternal, that he's eternally God, that when God appears to people, they're actually seeing Jesus. Now you make your own opinion about that. You study the scriptures and you decide for yourself on that. I'm not here to push that doctrine because there are many viewpoints on that. What I do find interesting is the fact that Joshua falls on his face to the earth. He bows down before him in worship. And he says, "What has my Lord to say to his servant?" He calls him Lord. This one with the sword drawn in his hand. This captain of the Lord's hosts. He tells him that this place he's standing is holy. Then you go into chapter 6. Now Jericho was tightly shut up because of the sons of Israel. And no one went out, no one came in. The Lord, capital L-O-R-D, there in verse 2, chapter 6, verse 2. That means that is the covenant name Jehovah, or Yahweh. The same Lord, the one who said, "I am that I am," to Moses. This is the same one that it's talking about. It says, "The Lord said to Joshua, 'See, I have given Jericho into your hand.'" Now, I don't believe that there was some transition that happened between chapter 5 and 6, that this is the same story, that this is the same instance, that the Lord speaks to Joshua. But I also want to be careful to not break the scriptures and say, well, this is what the scripture actually says. That the person there says back there in chapter 5, the captain of the Lord's host said to Joshua. That the scripture says that it was the captain of the Lord's host. That he himself says, "Rather, I indeed come now as a captain of the Lord's host," or the host of the Lord. Before that it says, "Behold, a man was standing opposite Joshua." Now, it says that it was a man. He himself says he's a captain. But then the book tells you in the next chapter, the Lord said to Joshua, the Lord himself spoke to Joshua. The only reason I point that out, the different language that's being used, as some of us want to keep it simplistic, okay, it was the Lord. It was the Lord. What did he actually say, though? Did he say that I am the Lord? He didn't say that, did he? He said, "I came as a captain of the Lord's host." Now, I'm not going to get into all the mystery of this, but I just want you to see that there is a mystery here, that it has been left up to interpretation. Now, some people would argue you get into chapter 6, there is no interpretation because the Lord himself said to Joshua. I'll leave that up to you. Because the same controversy and mystery will come up when it comes to the nature of who Jesus was, who Jesus is. We still have the same kind of arguments and the same kind of language that we use. And we say, well, was Jesus fully man or fully God? Or was he half God, half man? And the consensus in Orthodox Christianity is that he was 100% man and 100% God. Well, how can you have 200%? Well, it's because he's God. Well, why did he get tired? Because he was a man. Why did he get thirsty? Because he was a man. How did he die? If he was God, how could God die? Well, it's because he was a man. You see what I'm saying? Like, there's something in our brains that keeps tripping up on this. Like, we understand it. We can understand it, and we believe it. Like, we read this book, and it's like, it clearly gives divine attributes to Jesus. It clearly gives divine characteristics that only God can have. It gives to Jesus Christ. And we say that Jesus is God. And we talk about Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. No, you're fine. Go for it. We talk about Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And our minds will trip up when we think about this, and we go to great lengths to try to explain something that I believe is unexplainable. I believe that what we've been given is the explanation that we can handle. It's not that it's the best one. I don't believe that. I believe that the best explanation of God is going to be God himself. If that makes sense. Like, being in his presence and seeing him for yourself, then you will understand. But right now, in our finite minds, there's something that is illogical about what is happening here. And then he says, march around the city. I mean, the whole passage is cloaked in this mystery and has these different phrases that the thinking person, an intellectual person that's thinking about what's actually said, will have trouble reconciling some of these things together. I'm not saying that you can't reconcile them. I'm not saying that they don't go together. I'm just saying it's difficult. The Lord said to Joshua, "See, I have given Jericho into your hand with its kings and the valiant warriors." He says it in past tense. You notice that? It doesn't make sense, logically speaking. But he's talking in the past tense. He says, "I've already given it to you. I have given Jericho into your hand." Some of us, when God promises us certain things, some of us are looking in our hand and saying, "I don't see it." But when God talks to us about it, it's all past tense. Think about this. The Bible says that when you put your faith in Jesus Christ, you are saved. Past tense. You're saved. Right? You're already saved, but I'm dying. The confusion comes from a source, and I could tell you where that confusion comes from. That there was this time where this serpent slithered into the garden and said, "Did God really say that when you eat this fruit that you'll die?" It's the devil that's always bringing up controversy and bringing up confusion. It's the god of this world, little g, the god of this world that has blinded the minds of unbelievers, that they can't see the glorious light of the gospel of Jesus Christ. There's an enemy that wants to shroud these things in mystery when really it's just plainly said. It's plainly said. The Lord said, "Look, I have given Jericho into your hand." Don't argue. The walls are still standing when he says this. The walls are still standing when he says this. This is how crazy your God is. I use that word crazy because crazy is always a cop-out for stuff we don't understand. It's crazy. Doesn't make sense. To me, God's crazy. And I stand by that, and I don't mean it as an insult at all, because my God has done some crazy things in my life that don't make sense. Francis Chan wrote a book called Crazy Love. You familiar with that book? Have you ever read it? It's a great book. But he talks about how the love of God is so crazy because it does not make sense. It doesn't make logical sense. He loves people that hate him. He gave his life for a world that killed him. And he chooses to love us. God does some things that don't make sense to us. And he said through the prophet Isaiah, he said, "Look, my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. My ways are higher than your ways. As the heavens are high above the earth, so are my thoughts higher than your thoughts, and my ways higher than your ways. You shall march around the city. All the men of war circling the city once, you shall do this for 6 days." You know, it doesn't mention this, but I've often thought to myself, what if they're shooting arrows at them while they're walking around the city? How do you know that they didn't pour oil from the tops of the walls? You know, these were practices that people did in those times. They would stand on the walls and they would see the army coming towards them, and because they had the higher ground, they would shoot down at them. And here God's saying, march around the city. Now, of course, the scripture says that Jericho was shaken in their boots, that they were terrified. So most likely in this situation, because of the word that they'd heard, because of the gospel that had been preached to Jericho, they were afraid God was coming to get them. I believe that. The scripture talks about how that everyone was afraid of them. But still, did you maybe ever think that there was a captain in Jericho? There was probably a captain in an army in Jericho. Most likely there was at least minutemen. There were at least people who were common men that had weapons and they were ready to fight and defend their city. They had walls. If they were able to construct these huge walls around their city, certainly they had an army on standby. And the Lord says, march around the city for 6 days. Now imagine, just picture for a moment. Don't let it just be some story, but God tells you, look, there are people in there. You're going to go take the city. They're afraid of you. There's an army in there, but I want you to walk around their town for 6 days. Don't fight. Just walk around. Fully arrayed in your battle gear, though, too. It's like, look at this. All the men of war.
And they got trumpets, and they got the Ark of the Lord. They're going to march around the city with their banners, with the Ark of the Lord, with their trumpets, and with all their weapons. And you don't think someone in Jericho is going to do something or try to do something? I imagine in my mind all the time when I'm reading this that there had to have been some crazy things going on. At the least of it, some Dennis the Menace kid probably went to a window and shot something from a slingshot at them. If I, you know, I'm just saying, you know, kids will be kids. There's a good possibility. I would love to see the analog and the chronicles of the 6 days of Jericho. There are probably stories that we'll never hear, never heard, because they're not written down. But there's somewhere, there is this log, there is this entry, there is this diary writing of some crazy things that happened during that week. You know, little Joey got away from me, and he went out there and he threw a tomato at him. You know, whatever. I imagine that there were some pretty long days too. You're out there marching. You're out there in the hot sun marching around. And it's a desert region. If you're familiar with where Jericho is, and even the scriptures talk about the plains of Jericho, it's actually literally the deserts of Jericho. This is a place that was just desolate. And they're walking around at the command of the Lord, no doubt. Doesn't make sense. And I imagine how many men in those ranks that were walking that were thinking, really? This is what the Lord told us to do? Now, I know what the scripture says, and the men, they were valiant, they fought, and they had faith. But there is a lot of things that are said all the time that don't get written down. And I could just imagine the young upstart soldiers that were just kind of like, are you guys serious? Is this what we're doing? And then there were the older ones that had seen and had trusted in the Lord, and they'd been fed manna at this point. They're like, look, just chill. It's going to be good. It's going to be good. All right, we're just going to obey the Lord. Look, the ark's there. Joshua knows what he's doing. I trust this guy, right? He's been here before. Man, he went in here and he said that there was giants, and now he's telling us, you know, the Lord has confirmed his covenant with Joshua. Joshua said, this is what the Lord said. This is what we're going to do. And then you might have had those younger ones that were like, okay, I trust you. I've been marching out in the wilderness with you. We've been walking around. We walked across the Jordan River, okay? So if the Lord told us to do that, we'll do this. But I still have my reservations. You know, there are some people that are like that in the church. Been saved for years. It's like, you've seen what the Lord has done. He's answered your prayers. You've seen the mighty things that he's done in the church, in the community, in your life, on your job, while you were at school. You've seen all these things that God has taken you through. And then you sit in church and you're like, man, is this what he told us to do? Like, we're singing worship songs and some crazy dude is preaching, you know, and he's thumping his Bible and he's talking about Jesus. Like, is this really what he wants us to do right now? Shouldn't we be out there doing something else? Now, I'm not saying that you shouldn't. There might be some of you where the Lord is telling you to do something completely different. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that everybody needs to be in church on Sunday morning. Oh, there are some people that they don't like that. No, everybody ought to be in church on Sunday morning. Well, what if you're a surgeon? You know, there's an emergency surgery and you're on call. You know, that's all right. I think you're probably going to be fine to go do that surgery and do your job that God has assigned to you and blessed you with and miss church. It's fine. But right now in peacetime, I think it's good for us to worship. It's good for us to gather, and we get together, and there are some things that we do, but I know that there are many people that are sitting in the pews, even right now, that are like getting antsy, like, we're supposed to do something. I know God wants me to do something, and you're just sitting there. I get that way. I get real, real antsy. I'm just like, I need to go do something. I'll be sitting here reading my Bible. I'll be in my office, and sometimes I'll get a phone call from like Jim Mills and be like, hey, let's go witnessing to people. I'll be like, all right, Jim, let's do it. I was studying. Let's stop that. Let's go like talk to people about Jesus and see what happens, right? And you got to get out of that comfort zone. You got to be able to get up and move. Absolutely. I believe in that wholeheartedly. But a good majority of what we do as far as fellowship, at least in the West during peacetime, we have our trumpets, we have the Ark of the Lord, and we march around the city. Of course, we do it sitting in pews, but it's like we're marching around the city and we don't really see anything happening for some of us. He tells them to do this. Let me back up real quick. Listen, up to this point, Joshua is doing everything he can to obey the word of the Lord. Up to this point, he continues a trend. This isn't like the first time that the Lord has spoken to Joshua. Joshua tells him to march around the city, right? He tells him to march around the city. But what you have to realize is there is this buildup to chapter 6. That the first 5 chapters of Joshua are almost a characteristic shadow of the first 5 books of the Bible, the Pentateuch, the books of Moses. Why do I say that? First, there's 5 chapters. In the 5th chapter, before they get to this point, he circumcises everybody. Ugh. All right, for some people, they hear that. Look, these are grown men and some young boys. He circumcises them because, according to the law of Moses, the men were supposed to be circumcised. So he circumcises all the men before this battle. Listen, we'll keep backing up. Before that, they celebrated the Passover. There's a portion in there also where they crossed the Jordan River, just like Moses and them crossed the Red Sea. God speaks to Joshua in the first chapter and he tells him, look, this book of the law, it shall not depart out of your mouth. I'll be with you like I was with Moses. And he gives him the word. He creates in his mind and in his heart this necessity for what God has said. Like the first book of the Bible is all about God creating the world with his words. And in Joshua, he says, everything that I'm going to do with my words. So keep this book of the law in your mouth. The first 5 chapters, there's this remembrance of what God has said. Passover, his law, circumcision. And you get to this point, and the Lord says to Joshua, march around the city for 6 days. And I love this phrase. And it was so. Verse 8. And it was so. And when Joshua had spoken to the people, the 7 priests carrying the 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the Lord went forward and blew the trumpets, and the ark of the covenant of the Lord followed them. That at his word, after all that, at his word, the people did what he said to do. Now 6 days, they march around. On the 7th day, they go 7 times around the city. And so people, you look at the shadow and you think, okay, what's that talking about? We go back and we think, okay, in 6 days, God created the heavens and the earth, and on the 7th day, he rested. You see that, right? You see, this number 7 is always speaking of God as creator. It's this number of perfection and creation that is displayed by God. Not that creation is perfect, but that God himself said it is good. On the 7th day, he rested from all his labor. That's why when you look through scriptures, when you see the number 7, it's always a reference to God. In the book of John, from the time that Jesus is arrested to the time that he dies, there are 7 phrases uttered by Jesus. All of them, not in the English, but in the Greek New Testament, all of them completely divisible by 7, as far as number of letters and number of words. There's these 7s that appear in Scripture. You go to the book of Revelation. If anyone's read the book of Revelation, you see 7s all over the place. 7 lampstands, 7 churches, 7 trumpets. You remember that? 7 angels carrying 7 trumpets. Everybody familiar with that? When I read this passage of Scripture, I see this flash forward of the centuries and millennium of God's people on the earth. There's this amazing story here. That the people of God have been in this city. And some people are thinking, when I talk about the people of God, they think I'm thinking about the army marching around. There was this family that lived in the city. Remember that family? It was a family that brought in 2 spies, 2 messengers. Rahab. Are you familiar with Rahab? Look there in... There, where are we at? In verse 17, yeah. The city shall be under ban, and all that is in it belongs to the Lord. Only Rahab the harlot and all who are within her house shall live, because she hid the messengers whom we sent. Go with me. This is going to seem just a little out there, but I think you can see it if you just have faith. Trust in the Lord. Look, this is what I see. Within this city, the city that doesn't know God, there is someone who has received the 2 messengers from the Lord. And those 2 messengers said, okay, we're going to come back. And you need to hang a scarlet thread in the same window that we came out of the city. A scarlet thread. So here's this family in the city. They're living in the city that is without God, but they have believed the messengers of God. That right there, my friends, I believe is the church. Listen, There are two witnesses. We call them the Old and the New Testament. Rahab hid and protected and preserved the messengers from the people of the Lord. There's these walls that are built around the city, around this, can I use the word dimension? The majority of people living in this earth are without God. According to Jesus, broad is the way that leads to destruction. Narrow is the way that leads to life. Few there be that find it. The truth about Scripture is that the people of God are far outnumbered by the people of the world. So here you have this one family that hid and protected the messengers. You know how many people have died protecting this word to preserve it in this earth? Hundreds of thousands, millions, countless, to protect the messengers that God sent. And in their openings, they have a scarlet cord, a scarlet thread. We open with this. Our main portal, our speech, our preaching is the blood of Jesus Christ, which ties us and binds us all together. What I see is I see the Lord. Joshua is the type of the Lord. This army, these are his angels. Go with me on this. Go with me on this. Here's the picture. You have these walls around the city. You have the people of the world living in the city. You have Rahab the harlot, the church. She's a harlot. She's a sinner, but she's going to be saved. What a better description of the church. Can you think of a better description of the church? We're harlots, we've fornicated with the world instead of our husband, the Lord, but he's forgiven us and he's going to save us. So you have Joshua, the Lord, and his angels marching around the city for 6 days. The creation of the world, people argue about this idea of the world being 6,000 years old. But it's interesting that there is this stuff that's happening that we can't see because there's these walls that blind. Do you realize that there are angels marching around us right now? You just can't see them because there's this wall in the way blocking you from it. And everybody in this place is scared because when you begin to talk about those things that are on the outside entering into this same dimension, they freak out. They get upset. So here you have the Lord marching around the city 6 days, 6,000 years. We are on the cusp of the 7,000th year. Do you realize that? We are on the cusp of the seventh and final day. All the signs point towards it. And then it says that there the seven trumpets, like the seven trumpets in the book of Revelation, that the priests are going to blow the trumpets on the seventh day. And when they blow the trumpets, everybody's supposed to shout. The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with the voice of the archangel, with a shout, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall be raised. Do you see it? There's going to be a trumpet blast around outside of Jericho, a trumpet blast that the people inside the city are going to hear. And not only is a trumpet blast, but there's going to be a shout. And then the walls are going to fall. I'm telling you right now, this plane that we're living in here on earth, there is coming a time where everything that you cannot see is going to be open to you. And you are going to see things that you never thought of before, the things that they have been written about. And God himself, the Lord himself, is going to come from heaven with his mighty angels to destroy the city. And you know, there's one family that's going to be saved out of the city. One family, the ones who preserved the two messengers, the two spies that came in to tell them that the army is on its way. What does this thing talk about but the army that is on its way to judge the city? Have you protected the two witnesses? Are you guarding it? Have you placed the scarlet cord within your window? The blood of Jesus Christ. It flashes back to the Passover where they put the blood on the doorposts and they came out of Egypt. The death angel passed over their houses. And then the two spies say, do something similar. Take a scarlet cord and put it in the opening of your house for us to see. And when we come to destroy the city, your house will be saved. Are you living in Rahab's apartment right now? I'm telling you right now, the walls are going to fall. The world we are living in right now is about to change. And the Lord is just waiting to come through these walls. to march in on this plane of existence, and he's going to judge the entire earth. They destroyed the whole city. They destroyed the whole city except the family of Rahab. Now imagine for a minute, you're Rahab. You know the army's coming. You've watched them march around the city for 6 days. And here comes the seventh day. And you believe that this is the time that this city is going to fall. How many friends and family members do you think Rahab rushed to get into her house? Think about it. How many people did she try to save, knowing that her city, her world was going to come to an end? All that she knew was going to fall. And it was going to be signaled by a trumpet blast and a mighty shout. Go read the book of Thessalonians. The Lord himself shall descend with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with a mighty trumpet blast. At the last trumpet, the dead are going to be raised. We who are alive and remain will be caught up together with him. Those who are guarded by the scarlet cord, by the blood of Jesus Christ, they shall be saved outside the city, and the rest of it's going to be destroyed. We need a people of God who are not afraid to preserve the two witnesses and say what it says. And this book says a judgment is coming. Yes, we need to love. Yes, we need to serve. But the most loving thing you can do for someone is telling them that judgment is coming. I'm telling you right now, there are some people that don't like fire and brimstone preaching. I'm one of these people. I don't like it. I don't like to think that people are going to be destroyed. I don't like to think that people are going to die. And because I don't, I have to tell people the truth. Give your life to Jesus. Be tied to God by that scarlet cord. Just as Rahab saved her family by this one simple little signal. And that's, for some people, they struggle with that. They're like, could it really be that easy? All she had to do was tie a scarlet cord and her whole family was saved. Yes. Don't you realize that that's how easy the gospel is? The gospel says, believe on Jesus Christ, confess his name, and you shall be saved. It's really that simple. But for some reason, the majority of people are rejecting it, like, God is this, and I don't believe in that, and I don't believe in that, when it's this simple solution. I prove to you time and time again, God has proved to the world time and time again that he is real, that he's coming in judgment, and people still reject him. Bind yourself to him. Tie yourself to God through that scarlet cord, which is the blood of Jesus Christ. Put your faith in him today. Put your faith in his word. Trust in him completely. Be baptized into him. Amen. Can I get an amen? The walls are about to fall, people. We need to bring some people in. We need to save them. See, look, some people are trying to save people from hell. Here's the thing. We are, according to the scripture, we need to save people from the wrath of God. Never mind hell. The wrath of God is about to be poured out. He has saved us from him. He has saved us from his hot, burning anger. Church, it's our time now. We need to get busy letting people know. Letting people know, look, there's these two witnesses that came into my apartment. They tell me that there's an army coming. And that they're going to destroy this whole place. And if you just stay here with me, if you trust in what their message is, and you have the scarlet cord in your window, you'll be saved too. Put your faith in Jesus. Amen. Church, will you stand to your feet? Pray with me. Bring it.
This is you. I've never thought of this before, but it's coming to me.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm scared. But they marched around the town, Jared's the castle, or palace, 6 times, because that's to build up their faith. Mm. God has done something in my life, many times, that builds up my faith for things that come.
Mm. Mm. Amen.
And that's what it was for them. They marched around that. Probably had bows and arrows directed at them, or you know, they're standing on guard inside, and they know that this is a dangerous place to be, standing outside of this wall. That's a dangerous place to be, but they walked it, and every time they walked it, it became a little more relaxing. They got used to walking around and having people yell at them, and and things like this. They got used to it. The fifth time was easier than the fourth time. Mm. The sixth time was easier than the fifth time. And God slowly took them through these steps to build up their confidence. By the sixth time, they could walk it easy.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing bothered them because they knew God was going to protect them. And God did protect them. And he walked them around it to build up their confidence. You know, I told a lot of people this, but it wasn't my dad passed away a few days before. Dad was laying in bed, and Mom heard a commotion, and she walked in there, and Dad is waving his arms and laying there in bed and saying how beautiful it is. It's so beautiful. It's so beautiful. It's beautiful. The next morning, I'm waiting to hear what it was like. He couldn't remember.
Mm.
But I believe God had a purpose taking him through that. I don't think God took him through that for nothing.
No.
I think God took him through it to build up his confidence.
Absolutely.
So that he would know for sure God's going to take care of him. No doubts. And that's why he took these people around this building six times. Mm. He's building up their confidence.
Mm-hmm.
And he wants to do that with us. You know, when I went through that combine incident, that wasn't an accident. God was taking me through something to teach me to rely on him.
Praise the Lord.
To count on him. Don't worry about anything. Don't worry about going up in front of people.
Mm-hmm.
Don't worry about anything. Don't worry about going out and witnessing to people like we did. That was fascinating, but, you know, it was a new thing. It was kind of scary in a way.
Yeah.
You know, that you go out to people and talk about God. But God put me through some things like that combine to teach me that anything, he'll take care of me.
Yeah. Amen.
He can do it. And he took these people around that building until they were relaxed and confident and knew beyond a doubt that he could protect them if they went another step further.
Amen.
And I think that's wonderful. I don't want to take away anything you said because you're going right. You're right. You're right. But we got to look at it as we're getting ready.
Yeah, we are getting ready.
God's got to get us ready.
Yes, he does.
Because I think it's coming just like you do. And it won't be long. I don't know when or anything like that. But God put some things in my life, I think, just to get me ready.
Amen.
Not for any other reason. And I just thank you for helping
Amen.
Get me ready.
Remember, thank you for sharing that. Thank you, Jim. All right. I don't know who that was for, but praise the Lord. I know I got something out of it.
Oh, I want to thank you for tuning into our broadcast today. I hope that the message was powerful and that it impacted your life and encouraged you. I want to ask you, while you were listening to the message, was God speaking to your heart? Did you feel any conviction? Maybe you're a believer in God, you're a believer in Jesus, and you feel like God is calling you to change, maybe to change the path that you're on. Or maybe you've never made a decision to follow after Christ, to be a believer. If that describes you, I want you to pray a prayer with me right now. Will you do that? Just pray like this. Lord Jesus, I know that I've sinned. Please forgive me. I know that the Bible says that you shed your blood for my sin and that you paid the ultimate price at the cross. And I thank you for that. Forgive me now and cleanse me from my sin. Come into my life. Change me. Give me strength to follow after you. And I will continue to praise you and believe in you. Thank you in Jesus' name. Now, if you prayed that prayer with me, I want to encourage you that the Bible says that if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and confess his name, you will be saved. That's amazing news. I also want to advise you and caution you that following after Jesus is not always easy. But what can help is if you get yourself a Bible and read about him. Pray to him every day. And also try to find a group of friends, like a church or a Bible study or a prayer group you can be a part of, so you can surround yourself with loving and supporting people who are a positive influence in your life. That will make your journey with Christ that much better. If you've been blessed today, I just want to encourage you to share that blessing with others. Share it with us. If you received something from this message, shoot us an email. Or go to our Facebook page and like it. Or maybe go to our YouTube channel and subscribe there. You can also look at our archive of other videos and sermons and the special music that's been shared by the people of God here. I want to encourage you. There's a reason why you tuned in. There's a reason why God has brought this message to you. God is with you. Remember always that if God is for us, who can be against us? God bless.